Welcome to the Concordia College Football Show with Coach Terry Horan. I'm your host, Norman Bell. Terry, this game felt like a heavyweight fight that needed to be ended with a knockout, and you got that in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, we did. You know, that's a tribute to our young men and their conditioning and what we do. And it was a, you know, we really performed pretty well in all three phases throughout the day. But you're right, you know, you got two really good football teams battling it out. I think we wore on them at the end, and it was a great victory for us on the road for the second week in a row.
Well, let's go ahead and take a look at those first half highlights.
Here are boys coming out, locking arms, and excited to play at Gustavus, which is, you know, was
beautiful
a great
facility.
Day. A beautiful facility, a great day. So our kids were excited about the opportunity and opening kickoff right here. And they did a couple different twists on us that we weren't expecting, and you can kind of see kind of the confusion right in there with letting a few guys go back. Here's one of our third down plays to Herkler, and we actually dropped it, and that was a big drop that was on our first possession. We liked, obviously, when we get the ball, we like to march it down the field, and got a great punt by Eddie. It was about a 44-yarder. They get the ball, and, you know, a few plays here and there. We get a big pick by Aaron Arndt, and this was huge. They were on our 22-yard line on their first drive, so this certainly deflated their bubble right out of the gates too.
Yeah.
So we get the ball back offensively, and Mike does what Mike does best and runs and got a big play. And our offensive line was stellar all day long. And when you rush for 400 yards, you're doing something pretty well.
Yeah,
And I think all of our skill guys would tell you, Norm, that it was the people up front that paved the way for them. And, you know, Chad had a great day, and he was reaping the benefits of some great blocking in front of him. There's our first touchdown on the day and his first of four.
Yeah, he had was it a career day, 190 yards?
190-some yards. Yeah, that was a career day for him. There we missed a PAT. It's been a frustrating thing for us, and I know Eddie was really feeling not great about it, but he certainly stepped up to the plate as the game wore on. And here's our KO coverage. Our special teams played pretty well all day. This was one where we had them corralled pretty deep, but we let them out of there, and you know, they're making some plays. They've got athletes, you know, and they get their athletes in space, and they can do some damage. It's a freshman quarterback. He has good poise, and he's athletic, but there's a big play by our MIAC defensive. Was that Hank?
No, that was
Alex
Berg
right there,
yeah.
And he was the MIAC defensive player of the week, and Chad was the offensive player of the week, so we had two big individual performances with, obviously, our big win and team performance. Here's we're running our triple again, and Chad breaks through and busts a few tackles, and we had a little chat with him about just finishing his runs instead of stopping and trying to be cute. You're a fullback. You're not supposed to be cute.
Your second quarter.
Yep, here's a pitch to another one of our stellar backs, Jason Montoni, and again, good blocking and a little bit you know, more of a block, sustained block on the edge there by our X. We might have been in the end zone, and yeah. Chad gets in for the second time. And look at the love. We love when everybody runs, and because it's 11 guys doing the work there. There's a big PAT point after, and that's much better. So we're up 13-0, and you know, we know that they're not going to lay down and give up. They continue to keep battling, and we got them in another punt situation, and. You know, this is, it takes a backward Cobber bounce for us, but I thought we did a pretty good job on pretty much most of our special teams. Here he had a little bit of a pressure, and he was off balance when he threw, so we're off the field. Eddie gets another good punt, and our coverage does a really nice job. There was a good trip up by Jason Montoni.
And, he had a good day on special
teams.
Yeah,
he really did. You know, we had a few big performances. Zach DeClusion, a senior. We were really excited about what we saw from him on our KO coverage all day. Our defense had a fantastic day,
yeah.
You know, limiting to these guys to, you know, only 21 points and 60-some yards rushing.
And then this happens.
And then we throw a pick right off after a turnover. And we're trying to break a tendency, you know, and it was just one of those plays that you got to give the defense credit. They made a play, but we kept battling and back and forth, and this is nice when we can get Herx to catch the ball back there, and he's another weapon for us, and he picked up some positive yards.
And this right here, I'm not sure about that. I looked at it a couple times. It looked like his knee could have possibly been down, but I wasn't out there. So
yeah, and it's tough. We had three turnovers offensively, and that's something that, you know, that's, we need to work on that, because ball security is a must when you run our style of offense, and we're certainly going to need ball security this weekend. Here's a, you know, just a scramble. He got outside the pocket, and they didn't give up on it, and you know, they score right before half to make it 13-7.
And this will take us into halftime right here. When we come back, we'll take a look at those second half highlights. Terry, a couple of turnovers in the first half. What was the message you gave to the guys in the locker room at halftime?
You know, we really didn't dwell on the turnovers a whole lot. We just talked about, you know, obviously ball security is a must, but you know, we needed to go out and do what we do best, and really we were kind of stopping ourselves, and we shot ourselves in the foot a couple times in the first half, especially with some short fields, and you know, their 7 points came off of a turnover of ours. So ball security and what we do offensively, it's so important, but it wasn't something that we were dwelling on. You know, you don't want to always talk about it a whole lot, just continue to keep working and moving forward.
Right. Now, this third quarter was a blast. There was a lot of scoring going on this third quarter. Wade, why don't we roll that? Let's take a look at the second quarter. Second half, excuse me.
Yeah, second half highlights. There are a lot of them, yeah, and you're right. You know, the third quarter, there was a lot going on. And then the fourth quarter, which is our pride quarter, I thought we wore them out, and we wore them out, you know, the way we want to wear them out, and that's by running the football and chewing the clock and playing really good defense. And, again, special teams was – that was a big kickoff coverage. There's a big hit by Hank Van Loo, and he's just had really a stellar year for us at inside backer. We get him flushed out of the pocket. There's Sam Archer, their backup quarterback, and Van Loo comes out and makes a big third down stop, and they have to punt the football.
You guys get the ball rolling here in the second half.
Yep, and you know, we catch the ball, so we don't lose any yards there, and he gets a few positives, and now, you know, we'll let our running attack get going. Here's a little lead option play, and we get Chad out in the perimeter. We had some great perimeter blocks, and the little turf monster trips up Chad there again as he looks back, and we're all shaking our head at him. So nobody said anything in team film that on Sunday night either. Here's Mike running just a little option play and into the end zone, and again, great blocking by our left side of the line there to get him in. Eddie pops it through. You know, we didn't want to chase any points, so we decided to go for one, and we're up 20-7. Really another good kickoff. And I thought our guys did a pretty good job of corralling all day. We're number one in the league in KO coverage, and our kids really believe in what we're doing. And this was just, you know, their first play. And it was a coverage mistake, and didn't pick it up, and boom, it's 21-14. And probably, you know, a special team play that's probably extremely key after a big play is to forget about it and move to the next play. We always talk about the most important play is the next play. Well, here you go. Here's the next play. We get a 60-yard KO return by probably our fastest kid, Jason Montoni, and he gets tripped up about the 22-yard line. And three plays later, you know, we're in the end zone. And here's a little pitch out, a little lead option to Chad. He gets some positive yards off of it.
There it is,
yeah,
right there.
There you go. Look at that. Just a hard-fought run. And Ryan Seahawk, a sophomore from Detroit Lakes, his first varsity touchdown, and it was a good one. I mean, he got out of a missed tackle, and he hurdled a couple guys, and he's in the end zone. 26-14. We went for two, didn't capitalize on it. Our KO team's back out. Another great kick by Eddie. Eddie's been consistently five to the end zone, and there's a great play by Zach DeClusion, one of our seniors, and he came off the edge really nice. Another big play by Alex Berg, and 16 tackles on the day. It was, He had a full day at the office, especially with all the special teams he's on too. Here's the one I wish we could have had back, and so does Dylan Herkler too. I mean, we lost about 25 yards on that. We like to try to catch everything we can in the air so we don't lose yards. And then we had another fumble off of a handoff, and that's three on the day, and that's too many. Gives them a short field, and they capitalize. Now it's 26-21, you know, and it's just like you said, you know, third quarter is a lot of slugging back and forth. And
Hank Van Loo with the kick return.
Yeah, he goes back to his rugby days. As he was coming off, I go, look at you, you're back to your rugby days, and gave him a little high five. And here's a little inside veer, triple option, and Michael gets it out to Jason, gets out on the edge and the perimeter, and we had a pretty good perimeter blocking. Now we're into the fourth quarter, and that four in the air, that's a pride quarter, all right? We got a lot of tradition in our program, and that was the biggest play of the game, probably right there. You look up at the clock at the end, they said 12 yards. We all knew that we had 18 yards passing on the day, but that 12-yard pass play was a third down and eight that kept the drive alive, and then we end up scoring here, and then all of a sudden I kind of deflated them. It really did, and we were able to make a couple big plays defensively. But here's Chad getting into the end zone, and we're up 32-21.
There's the ensuing kickoff, and
got a few yards, but again we corral it pretty good and don't give up too much. And you know, they have these guys are, you know, they're competitive and they play hard, and they're not gonna give up. But this was a big sack by us, and
forcing the punt again.
Forcing the punt. Our D's were just stellar all day long, and we complemented each other really, really well. Here's the best return probably of the day by Dylan, and it's about a 12-yard punt return. This was another big, it came off a play-action pass, but Conley, with good coverage on him, you know, I don't know how he made that catch, but he makes it. And then Mike, again, does what Mike does best, and he finds some seams and runs hard.
Yeah, here you go.
Yeah, here's a little counter play off our toss fake, and you got probably one of the best pulling machines in the conference. And Josh Berg coming around the corner, and Montoni, who was exhausted right there in the fourth quarter. It was hot on the turf,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, he was cramping up out there.
Yeah, he was. So now it's 39-21, and we really kind of, at that point, it was pretty much over.
Today, you can honestly say your guys finished. They came out and they finished. Once they smelled blood in the water, they attacked it.
Yeah, that was another four-quarter game. And we always talk about playing 60, and we needed to do that. And, you know, you look at our last two road trips at Bethel and at Gustavus, we finished extremely well. Yeah, Coach Kostich, he'll see this, and he's going to wonder if I won this argument at all. He always gives me a hard time on that, but that seriously was about a 20-minute delay, and
yeah, it
didn't need to be that long. Just make the decision and go and live with it. But we got a big sack off of it with Dylan Connor.
Look at him. The hometown boy.
He had about 40 Connors sitting in the stands screaming and hollering. And it's good to see Kirby Seward back in action,
yeah,
too. He hadn't been
yeah.
back since Jamestown. There we plug in the, you know, the nail into the coffin. And Chad Johnson got his fourth touchdown on the day. And, again, he was the MIAC Offensive Player of the Week.
Convert on another extra point, and that'll wrap it up right there.
Yep.
46-21 victory over Gustavus Adolphus. Coach, that's a great road win and a great environment. They had a lot to celebrate down there, and you guys came away with the win. That's tremendous.
It really was. You know, when you come off an emotional win like we did with Bethel, and then you have a bye week. And, you know, I'm not a huge fan of bye weeks. I don't know if they ever come at a great time. We were able to heal some of our guys, though that was the positive. But when you get a big win like we had at Bethel, you like to carry that into the next week. And you just never know how your team's going to respond, okay? Our practices were good during our bye week, and leading up to the Gustavus game, you just didn't know how things were going to go. But proud of our kids. They played four quarters. We played in all three phases. We still have a lot of coaching points. We're still, you know, got a lot of things we can do to get better at. But I was proud of them. And that, you're right. They had a lot of celebration going on. It was their homecoming, 100 years of football. And Gustavus has a proud tradition, and I'm happy about the victory, especially where, you know, that's our last loss last year, there was a little sour taste in our stomachs all off season about our loss at Gustavus. So it's a big win for the Cobs.
Yeah. Well, the long ride home felt good.
Felt great. You bet it did.
When we return, we'll catch up with senior offensive lineman Jon Asprey. Joining us now is Jon Asprey, a senior offensive lineman and captain from Brainerd, Minnesota, who happens to be a health and physical education major. Thank you for joining me, Jon.
Thanks for having me.
So what do you want to do with that health and physical education major?
Ideally be a stay-at-home dad. No, I'm just kidding. I want to go the teaching and coaching route for a little while there and then go back and hopefully get my master's in some sort of administration within a school.
Okay, now at Brainerd High School, you participated in football and track.
Yep.
What was your event in track?
Discus and shot put. I actually broke our school record in the discus, too, so pretty cool accomplishment.
Awesome, awesome. You know, it's ironic because I was talking to a cousin of mine. They were had to fill out some information for the National Honor Society. It's a process you have to go through, and you were on the National Honor Society.
Yeah, I was.
That's a good student.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I like to pride myself in my academics, and I do pretty well, so.
Good.
Yeah.
Good for you. So what made you choose Concordia College?
Yeah, so I know a lot of guys from Brainerd actually go to Concordia, and a lot of football players go to Concordia. Coach Willits calls Highway 10 the pipeline, and that's where he recruits a lot of. So Willits got in contact with me, and I got up and visited a couple times, and I liked it. I visited other places, and then just something about it was like, you know, this place kind of feels right. And I was actually at a track meet, and Coach Rand was texting me. And then right after the track meet, I was just like, you know what? I'm going for it. So I called Coach Rand, said, I'm coming. He was pretty fired up, and then never looked back, and it was the best decision I've ever made.
Good, you got a good one. What's the academic environment like at Concordia?
It's a little bit more than other schools, but I think if you just stay on top of your game and chip away at it each day and put the time in, it's great education. You're going to get a world-renowned education, actually, with some of the best stuff you can get. So it's just a little more challenging, but you just got to put your time in, and it all pays off.
And as a captain, what type of leadership skills do you possess?
I like to lead by example more. I'm not the most vocal guy when it comes to rah-rah, stuff like that. And I also just like to show others around me, like, that I'm having fun. This is football, and we play it because we love the game. And I like to try and show that to everyone.
Right. Now, Josh Berg said the same thing, but I caught him being very vocal.
Yeah, he's a little more of a vocal guy than I am. Yeah.
So, good for you. So, speaking of Josh, you guys are really good up front, man. You move well. You guys get to the second and third level in blocking. How does it feel to be able to rush for 400 yards against a really good team?
Exhausting, but it's every O-lineman's dream having them run the ball behind you as much as we did on Saturday. 400 yards, that's awesome. And we were really tired after the game, but it felt really good.
The running backs were really appreciative. Every time I asked them, they could not stop commending you guys on the holes you were opening up for them.
Yeah, that was a good one.
So, coach, teaching and coaching, would you like to go home or stick around here?
I'm really up for whatever. It doesn't really matter to me. I know there's a couple openings back in Brainerd within the next couple of years, so maybe go back there, but I'm definitely open to whatever opportunity presents itself.
All right. Well, thank you for joining me, Josh. Appreciate having good guys like you around here.
Thanks for having me.
That was senior offensive lineman Jon Asprey.
Up front, things were clicking for us, definitely up front. And, I mean, it's a two-way street for us. I mean, they give us all the praise, but all the praise goes back to them, too, because they got to find the field and find the holes. And it's just really fun seeing them get out in space and do their thing.
I'd like to welcome in Coach Dale Hertel, co-offensive coordinator and quarterback's coach, to the show. Coach Hertel, thank you for joining us.
Jake Christensen.
You played for Jake Christensen, excuse me.
His name is on the stadium, I think.
Yes, the Jake, yes.
The Jake.
And you are MIAC MVP in 1970?
I was.
Wow, what an accomplishment.
Oh, thank you. It was a lot of fun. It was Jim Christofferson's second year that he had been there, and had a chance to play for him for 2 years, and I played for Jake for 2 years, my 4 years that I was here.
Okay. Okay, now when did you come back to start coaching here?
Well, I coached 5 years in Ortonville, Minnesota in high school, and then I coached 21 years at Fargo South High School in Fargo before I came here. So this is my 20th year now that I've been coaching at Concordia.
So up until 97, anyone that I'd known that played for Fargo South that was pretty good, you coached them?
Pretty much, yeah.
That's a pretty good list of players.
We had a great run at Fargo South. Yes, we did. We had some super athletes, and we were very successful because of that.
You're also credited with guiding the two-time MIAC MVP, Brian Schumacher.
Outstanding quarterback, and just a fine young man. It was a pleasure for me to coach him.
As co-offensive coordinator and quarterback coach, what's some of your duties throughout the season?
I just kind of follow the quarterbacks. No, you keep involved, keep them thinking the game. We talk about, you know, all the things that tactically that we do, and we try and teach Concordia football a little bit too, because we don't run the same kind of football as everybody else, but we do the same things that make us effective offensively. We try and control the ball. Philosophically, if we can get 4 yards on first down, we're successful on first down. If we can get half the distance to a first down on second down, we're happy with that, and then third down, we try and get a first down. If we don't, we're not afraid to run the ball and go for it on fourth down. So that's our goal, is to keep the football. And offensively, that's pretty much how we start. And then we build around that.
Okay. Now, over the past 46 years, how has this campus changed?
It has changed a lot. Matter of fact, right now, I probably would be sitting in the old biology hall, which was a barracks, a green wooden building that was a barracks, and army barracks, as a matter of fact, that was left over. So that's where I learned biology. I was anatomy, physiology, biology instructor. I taught health and phy ed. I taught in high school and earth science, and that was kind of my background here. Concordia gave me a great education and a great start.
Okay. And how has football changed here?
Football's changed a lot. If you look at the equipment and the kinds of things that we did, I did have a face mask when I played, but it had just come out just prior to that. 50 years ago is a long time. They were single bars a lot of the time, not the cages and the whole thing. But I didn't wear a leather hat. I had one when I was a kid growing up. I used to come over here and watch them play in leather hats, which was kind of fun. I had a lot of heroes, hometown heroes that I watched. I'm a Moorhead boy, so I originally hung around here at Concordia and tried to sneak in here to play basketball in a gym and do the things that kids trying to do today too. So I grew up in the area. I've kind of been around it my whole life, and if anybody wanted to get together and talk about old times, I'm sure I could share a lot of good stories with them.
And just from a football standpoint, the locker rooms, the way they are now compared to probably, I don't even know what they would have been like in 1970.
In 1970, we had Memorial Auditorium. My freshman year we came here, we didn't have a locker room on the football field facility. Okay. In 64, they had just built the stadium. It was Jake had put that together, and it was a fine facility. And following that, they put in the locker room that's out there. And the locker room probably only held 75 people then at the time. Mm-hmm. And we're double that now. And so the facility we have now is really a tremendous update. I think probably the biggest change is the turf. I was very fortunate coaching at Fargo South High School that I had AstroTurf at Dakota Field that our teams played on, and that was an advantage for us. You could always depend on the footing and the kinds of things that you could do on that field, and it carries over today too. And I think maybe that's one of the reasons why I lasted so long too, is it's hard on a person's body to even coach on hard ground that we do have here in the Red River Valley. Mm-hmm. But turf is a great addition and super facility.
And just from a conference standpoint, what are some of the differences today as opposed to back when you played?
You know, there's still the rivalries of old. We don't necessarily play the same teams we played. When I played, we were NAIA, mm-hmm. and we played Augustana, and we played Duluth and teams like that, which are Division II teams now. And Morehead State, of course, is Division II also. And so we'd play like three games a year of Division II school caliber type schools. And we did very well against them. Matter of fact, Concordia is kind of where football started here in the Red River Valley. We were national champions, I believe, in 64. And that kind of changed the whole picture here. And when I was a kid growing up, I wanted to be a Concordia football player. I think everybody wanted to play for the school that was doing, you know, the things that we were doing at the time, which was win football games. And we had enthusiasm, and everybody kind of wanted to be a part of that growing up.
Well, it was a pleasure having you on the show. I really appreciate you taking the time to join us.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you. Okay.
That's Coach Dale Hertel, co-offensive coordinator and quarterback's coach. Welcome back. Coach, homecoming week.
Yeah, well, it's a pretty special week. And, you know, homecoming on Concordia's campus is really cool. There's a lot of old school traditions that we still really embody here. And I know our players love playing at home. And it's usually our biggest crowd, too. And it's going to be an exciting one. I mean, we've got the number two team in the country coming into our place, the national runner-up from a year ago, and a very good football team in St. Thomas, a well-coached football team, but they got a ton of really good athletes. So this will be a huge challenge for our kids, but it's going to be an exciting one.
Yeah. What do you guys need to work on to really be successful against them?
Well, you know, ball security is obviously important, but we just got to continue to do what we do best and not get too fancy and flashy. And, you know, we're going to have to stay on the field offensively, something that we weren't able to do a year ago with their defense. And they run extremely well. They're very athletic, and, again, they're well coached. But in all three phases of the game, we've got to be on our A game. And the last 2 weeks, you know, we hope has prepared us well. But we just got to go out and continue to keep doing what we do best and get better at it and give it our best shot.
Thanks a lot. Good luck this week, Coach.
Hey, thanks, Norm. Appreciate it.
Homecoming this Saturday, October 8th, 1:10 kickoff against St. Thomas.